People are, understandably, and so am I, preoccupied with the murder of two policemen in New York. I'd like to bring something to your attention here. If you have my book, Still the Best Hope, on page, at least in the paperback edition, on page 122, you will find the following. In 2011, in Tucson, Arizona, a man named Jared Luffner attempted to kill Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords, and he did, in fact, kill six people. The entire world of the left immediately announced that the murders were a result of Republican and conservative hate-filled rhetoric. The day after the shootings, New York Times columnist Paul Krugman already knew it was right-wing hate that had provoked Luffner to murder. Quote, "It's the saturation of our political discourse and especially our airwaves." That's us at talk radio. "With eliminationist rhetoric. Understand what that means? Eliminationist is the term for exterminating people. That lies behind the rising tide of violence. Where's the toxic rhetoric coming from? Let's not make a false pretense of balance. It's coming overwhelmingly from the right. So will the Arizona massacre make our discourse less toxic? It's really up to GOP leaders. Will they accept the reality of what's happening in America and take a stand against eliminationist rhetoric? Or will they try to dismiss the massacre as the mere act of a deranged individual and go on as before?" Unquote. As it turned out, the Tucson massacre was entirely, quote, "the mere act of a deranged individual," unquote. But the left, beginning with the New York Times columnist, used the tragedy to demonize the right, as it did with the Kennedy assassination. Krugman and the New York Times blaming the right for Luffner was so premature and so wrong that in a rare moment in American journalism, one major newspaper attacked the morality of another. The Wall Street Journal attacked the New York Times under the heading, "The New York Times has crossed a moral line." And Pulitzer Prize-winning Washington Post columnist Charles Krauthammer responded to Krugman in a column titled, "Massacre, Then Libel," with the sentence, "The origins of Luffner's delusions are clear. Mental illness. What are the origins of Krugman's?" Hi, everybody. I'm Dennis Prager. So when Jared Luffner murdered six people and tried to murder Gabby Giffords, the congresswoman from Arizona, the left blamed the right for its rhetoric. There was no truth to it whatsoever. It was a libel. It was pure lie. That's what a libel is, a lie to defame. Truth is not a left-wing value, and therefore, anything could be said so long as it's destructive to your enemies in politics. So they lied. And the Wall Street Journal, amazingly, said the New York Times crossed the moral line. You never see that. Never see that in major journalism. Crosses that moral line regularly, but so be it. Now, we have the following. We have police officers murdered. And the chants that went up in New York and elsewhere were, among some, not all, obviously, but among many of the protesters, "What do we want? Dead cops. When do we want them? Now."
Yeah.
There's a guy yelling the questions through a megaphone, then getting the response from the crowd. Any right-wing groups chant something analogous, eliminationist rhetoric? Any right-wing groups? Any conservatives? Any conservative protesters about anything that conservatives, on the rare occasion they actually have a demonstration, talk, say? The ratio of hate to non-hate, left to right, is about 10,000 to 1. My whole life it has been that way. I'm not saying it was always that way in every country, but it was always that way my lifetime in the United States of America. The hey, LBJ, have you killed any babies? How many babies have you killed today? That came from the left. Everything they project onto the right is indeed a projection. So here is another example. Hey, we can blame the right for Jared Loeffner, but you can't blame any of our people, any of our rhetoric about the racist police for what this guy did, who did it in clearly. I mean, he said so, why he was doing it. Because of the two verdicts of the grand juries that he didn't agree with. The left is morally incoherent, and that's the nicest thing I can say about them. But it is, it's a right-left issue. Not a Jew-Christian divide, there's a right-left divide. Same with black-white. Blacks who, isn't it amazing? Blacks who are conservative, they don't feel it's a racist country. How's that? How did that exactly happen? Does their complexion change because they're conservative? I don't think so. So why is it that black conservatives think that they're blessed to live in the United States? Could it be because if you're on the left, you don't feel blessed to live in the United States? Oh, bingo! Hey, we might have hit something here. If you crap on this country enough, you produce bitter people. And if you crap on it more and more and more, you produce people with pathologic views of the society, which is what dominate. Those views dominate the university. And in it, I have this the perfect example of the left-wing columnist Paul Krugman blaming Gabby Gifford's shooting, the congresswoman from Tucson, her shooting, blaming it the next day on right-wing eliminationist rhetoric. And it turns out that the guy wasn't right-wing at all. It was, and by the way, he never gave examples. We have an example here of eliminationist rhetoric on the left. Don't we? What do we want? Dead cops. When do we want them? Now. The grand juries may have well been right. This is a very disturbing trend now, that people know what happened better than grand juries do. Grand juries indict regularly. Case of Michael Brown, everything pointed to the officer's story being accurate. And in the case of Eric Garner, he was not killed by the chokehold. He was taken down, let go, and then he couldn't breathe because he was apparently having a heart attack. It's a tragedy. Is there a better way to bring that guy down? I don't know. I don't know, frankly. There may be. I just don't know it. He's a very large man. And people forget there was a black lieutenant who was supervising the entire thing. She could have stopped it at any time. If the lieutenant was responsible in the Rodney King affair, then the lieutenant is responsible here as well. So that's the story, morning glory, as they say. The social movement of hashtag Black Lives Matter condemned the killings in a statement, calling the loss of life senseless. There's a new idiocy of the left. Whenever you have an Islamic terrorist behead somebody senseless, You have this black guy kill two cops, stating why he's doing it. Senseless. What does that mean, senseless? What does it mean, senseless? It's not senseless at all. If you believe that, it makes sense. If you believe that the police are racist and kill blacks because they don't value black lives, it's not senseless to kill a cop. I'm sorry. You can say it's wrong, but it isn't senseless. Your reaction is senseless. Senseless. With all the hate for the police, hatred, lies about how they don't care about killing blacks, coming out of the world of the black and white left, is it really senseless to kill a cop? Frauds. There were moral frauds, all of them. Want to play that? Can we play that from earlier about... Okay, so you have people chanting, what do you want, dead cops? When do you want it now, right? You have that chanting from these folks. So why is it senseless? Let's say anybody who chants that, is it senseless for them to kill a policeman? Why does hashtag Black Lives Matter make that stupid comment? Police stink. They don't give a damn about black life, but it's senseless to kill a cop? No. Maybe you could say it's wrong, as I said, but I mean, it's not senseless. That some people put two and two together. We want cops dead now. Okay, I'll work on it. In 2011 in Tucson, Arizona, this is from my book, Still the Best Hope. It's about Paul Krugman. And we'll hear what he says about the murder of the two police officers and rhetoric after the libel that he waged against the right with this. A man named Jared Loughner attempted to kill Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords, and he did in fact kill six people. The entire world of the left immediately announced that the murders were a result of Republican and conservative hate-filled rhetoric. The day after the shootings, New York Times columnist Paul Krugman already knew it was right-wing hate that had provoked Loughner to murder. Quote, it's the saturation of our political discourse and especially our airwaves with eliminationist rhetoric that lies behind the rising tide of violence. Where's that toxic rhetoric coming from? Let's not make a false pretense of balance. It's coming overwhelmingly from the right. So will the Arizona massacre make our discourse less toxic? It's really up to GOP leaders. Will they accept the reality of what's happening in America and take a stand against eliminationist rhetoric? Or will they try to dismiss the massacre as the mere act of a deranged individual and go on as before? Of course, it turns out it was exactly that, the mere act of a deranged individual. He didn't give a single example of eliminationist rhetoric on the part of the right, but we can give hundreds of examples of hate-filled rhetoric toward the police. See, you could say, racist, you're racist, you're racist, you're racist, you're racist, you don't care about black life, you shoot wantonly at blacks, and then, oh my God, somebody actually killed a policeman? Shockaroo! Yeah. That's isn't that something? They're just stunned. They can't believe it that would happen after all of that. It's just stunning.
Jefe, what is a plethora?